The obituaries which appeared in the newspapers on Saturday, June the 24th, the day after the discovery of his body on Hampstead Heath, and on Sunday, June the 25th, though written in different styles and for different readers, brought out in sharp outline the main facts of Sir Robert's career. He was born in the slums of Southwark and educated in an elementary school. He began to earn his living at 14 as a grocer's assistant. He rose to be a manager, while still in his 20s, in one of London's multiple stores, and was soon picked out by the managing director of his firm for an executive post, since when, as the writers of many obituaries so aptly expressed it, he never looked back. There was perhaps nothing that had distinguished Sir Robert's early career from the careers of other successful self-made men. Where Sir Robert did strike out in an entirely new line was in his utter disregard of the lines of demarcation between different industries. It was, of course, a piece of utter lunacy, he once declared in a much-quoted public speech, for industries depending on the same sources of supply to compete with each other and thus encourage the increase of economic waste, the most poisonous weed in the fields of modern industrial development. Sir Robert Boniface, it was the almost unanimous verdict of the press, was one of those rare industrial geniuses who not only thought in advance of his time, but also succeeded in putting his ideas into action. He, at any rate, acted on the principle that the industrial development of one country to the detriment of the rest of the world was no longer possible, but that the well-being of one country today depended on the well-being of every other country in the world. The Industrial Development Trust Limited, the gigantic industrial and financial edifice erected by Sir Robert Boniface, was not confined to Great Britain or to the British Empire. It had subsidiary companies, known under different names, in almost every country in the world. But its various aliases were merely intended as a sop to the strong nationalist sentiments which had sprung up in the world since the Great War. In reality, it was one and the same concern which owned oil fields in Europe, Asia, and America, coal and mineral mines in Great Britain, Germany, the United States, Australia, and China, and tracts of forests and paper mills in Canada, Norway, and Finland. It also owned factories, multiple shops, and distributing agencies of all kinds in almost every country in the world.